But Gary Barlow, welcome to Scala Radio.
Thank you. Thank you.
Now, I'm excited not just because Christmas is around the corner, but because you have a new album out, which involves not just your amazing songwriting, but an 80-piece orchestra as well. Now, why did you want to make this particular album with these particular forces?
Well, you know what? These things never quite arrive the way I think people think they do. In a way that I was on tour last year. We were celebrating a 30-year anniversary. I know what you're going to say. I don't look old enough. But did you notice I had to say that then, not you? But anyway, so I was on tour.
I know.
I'm sure I sent that through to your agent. But anyway, you clearly didn't get it. So I was on this tour. And the problem is with me is that I am a devil for thinking about what's next. I'm a big planner. I'm always, next year I'm going to do this. And what happens is, I get distracted then because, of course, next year's shinier, more exciting than the thing I'm doing right now. So I promised myself last year, I'm going to be on this tour. I'm not going to think about what's next. I'm going to be in the moment, as that, you know, that buzzword. I'm going to be in the moment every night. And you know what? I was right throughout the tour. I was in the moment. I was loving it. And then about a week before the end of the tour, I had this title came into my head, Music Played by Humans. So I was thinking, oh, that's good. I like that. But what is it? What is it? You know, and I knew the band wanted a couple of years off. So I knew I was going to do a solo record, first one in 7 years. So, it, you know, I had a lot inside I wanted to say, but what is this Music Played by Humans? I couldn't work out what it was. And then it hit me. That all the years I've been making music, I have used musicians, but very small groups and very sparsely. The orchestral sound's never been really big in my music. We've had strings on stuff, you know, but again, never with any great determination to make a real point of it. And I thought, that's what it is. And you know, here I am, approaching 50, my audience, it's time they deserved a richer, more grown-up version of one of my records. So that's where it started.
Well, it doesn't get much richer, does it? I think with an 80-piece orchestra, so many different styles and sounds captured, and the people you're collaborating with, people like Alicia Dixon, Barry Manilow, James Corden. Is this a sort of a celebration of music making? Because this was recorded just before lockdown, wasn't it? The final session, just before everything changed.
That's right. So basically, what one of the downsides of this whole situation this year is that I think I've had to tell people how early we finish these records. And I'm always wary of it because no one wants music from last year. They want it from yesterday, like it's just been written. But, you know, I was working quite far in advance on this because I didn't really, because I'd never done an album like this before. I wanted to make sure I had time to make mistakes, I guess is the best way of putting it. And so we did start early, and thankfully it all worked in our favour because we did do our last big orchestral session about 12 days before lockdown. Now, I know you will probably tell your listeners all the time that I couldn't record this album at the moment, you know, to get the style of performances I needed for this record. I'm afraid it requires musicians to be sat shoulder to shoulder, feeling each other's timing, hearing each other's tuning, feeling the excitement being driven by the band leader. All of those things, they're not possible if people aren't close together. And that was the point. That was why it was such a relief to get it, because I knew I had those performances.
When you were writing them, before you got into the studio and you were, as you say, shoulder to shoulder with these musicians, what did you have in your head when you were writing? I'm interested to hear, did you hear an orchestra in your head when you were writing these songs? Did you hear a melody on its own? What do you hear when you're writing a song, Barry?
Yeah, do you know what? I have to say, no 2 days are the same for me, because you're right. Sometimes as I'm writing, I can hear what the instrumentation should be around it. But there's other times where I don't. I'm more focused. I think it probably depends on the lyrical content, because, for instance, a song like Incredible, which has got a big band flavour, you know, the lyrics aren't, they're not meaningful lyrics, they're playful lyrics. And so what I was almost trying to do was give the chance for the saxophones to answer me back. So it wasn't like I'm digging in my heart to find these lyrics today. It was more of a playful idea that required the energy then of musicians to bring that playfulness out. As if I was writing a song like This Is My Time, which is the piano and string, I wasn't thinking of anything but the piano and the melody and the lyric.
It's interesting what you say about the kind of dialogue between you and the instrumentalists around you, because that's a very classical thing. You know, it's like a musical ping pong game where an idea is taken by a soloist and batted back and forth with the orchestra. So do you think there's a classical concert piece in you? Is there a synth in Gary Barlow?
Do you know what? The one thing I've learned, I've only learned one main thing in my time, and that's to stick at what you're good at. And I've been given a tiny bit of musical talent, and I've always lived in the pop world. And I'm afraid I have too much respect for those amazing composers that I do. I'm going to stay in my world and leave that gig to someone else.
You know, I'm going to politely disagree with you, Gary. Talking about a tiny talent. Everybody in the Scala office will watch this interview back and laugh, because they know how much I admire you as a writer. And I come from a kind of orchestral background as a composer. And yet there's so much crossover between genres, and your album really reflects that, and the different collaborations that it reflects as well with the different solo artists with you. You know, it's an interesting sort of conversation. Music is always a conversation between different genres. And, you know, think about Paul McCartney. He's collaborated with classical composers to work with...
I loved that album, by the way. He did a completely classical album, didn't he? It was in about 2010 or something. I loved that.
Yeah, and he wrote in the 90s as well for the Royal Liverpool Philharmonic.
Wow, okay.
It's not, you know, people like Elvis Costello as well. There's a lot of crossover. Yeah, so yeah. Just planting a seed in your mind there. You never
know. Well, do you know what? I think the thing is that, you know, when we're in conversation like this, it's one thing. But I think when, and I always kind of play down what, I think we spend our life sort of playing down what we do. But when it does get serious and I close the door and the outside world's not allowed in, who knows musically where we... I don't even know if we decide. You know, we come to the studio and we think, right, okay, I'm going to, you know, I'm going to come up with a new idea today. And suddenly an angel flies down and lands on your shoulder. And it could be anything. It could be a flavor of rock music. It could be a flavor of classical music. I mean, that to me is why I'm still here doing this, is because the unpredictability of music, the times that I've written something and it has changed my life. It's changed the course of my life. And I tend to try not to big up what we do, but we change other people's lives through how we express and what we put out there. And that's unbelievably powerful. And it makes it unbelievably addictive to keep doing it, because you just never know what's going to happen. And that's why I come to be, for the thrill of that, I come in here every day.
When something is so unpredictable, and it can be, I should say it, or certainly for me, it can be quite scary sometimes, because you do sometimes have a week where you think, I haven't written three songs this week. What's happened to me? You know, are there things that you do to try and encourage creativity, non-musical things that get that inspiration flowing?
Well, hang on. So let me just go back. There's a few answers to what you've just asked me there. The first is, is that that voice that says you've not written, you can't, that will go over time, because I don't fear that anymore. I used to, because I had a patch in the early noughties where I didn't write for about 3 years. And it was nothing to do with my skill or creative. I'd lost my confidence. And confidence to me is the bit where, if you said to me, you know, what does a music manager do? It's not taxes or booking tours or getting record deals. It's none of those things. A manager is there to keep the artist's confidence healthy and in place, because without that, I've lost it, and I know how debilitating it is. It just takes all your creativity away. Now, I mean, I'm in a good place. I have been for about 14, 15 years. I write every day. If I don't write every, I do, honestly. If I'm not in the studio writing, there's something that will happen where I'll write it down. So that will go over time, that will. That's just your own little voice in your head telling you that. But to answer the second part of your question, I've learned so many great tricks from amazing people over the years of how to keep yourself fresh and how to make sure that I don't come in and sit at that and play a C every day and go, well, why is it not sound great? You know, why does this sound like the same as last week? It's because you sat in the same place playing the same chords. It's like go into different keys, play in keys you've never played in. Take a holiday, book a hotel on a beach in Cornwall for a week and change the scenery. I mean, it's just tricks like that that to me make me feel like I've never done this before.
It's interesting you sort of talk about confidence and mentioning a holiday, that kind of idea of relaxing. Do you write best when you're relaxed then? Is there a state of mind and emotion that you find particularly creative?
I'm a bit of a weird one. I write at high pressure. I like it when we've all sat round on a big Zoom call and, you know, there's four directors and there's the film company. I love that. I absolutely love it. And they've sent you off and you have to deliver then. That is, to me, like, okay, team, let's do this. To me, that's the excitement. And I must say, it's a funny thing of what we get from what we put out there. But to me, that first play to a record label or to a director or to a producer, that first play when they love it, that's kind of it for me. It never gets better than the first play. You know, records being released, and I don't know. There's something about that initial hit where it never supersedes that for me.
When you're, you know, operating under such pressure and you know who's going to be listening in some major boardroom somewhere in the world, does that mean you're having to turn out songs quite quickly? Are you, you know, in the sort of good old 1930s songwriter tradition, you're having to, as you say, you write a song a day. Are you having to write a song in 15, 20 minutes sometimes?
It's never quite that tight. But basically, if someone, I'll give you an example. I can't tell you the movie, I'm afraid, because I've signed an NDA for it. But I had a big thing in about June where I picked my phone up and there was about 21 people waiting for me on FaceTime. And I looked in the corner. That's Hans Zimmer in the corner. And he started talking, you know, we've got this movie. We're going to da-da-da-da-da-da. And he was talking me through it. And then I thought, oh my goodness, I know what this movie is, because my kids were, I mean, it was like, okay, this is a massive opportunity, this. And so they all did their speech and then they sent me a private link to the movie, which only I could open. I mean, it was proper Bond stuff, you know. So I thought, okay, this is it. I've got it. And so what you want to do then, is because, you know, you want to definitely deliver, but you want to deliver like this is the number one thing in your world right now. You don't want them to feel like they're fifth down the list. And so I just get to work. So by the time everyone got up the next morning, my song was in their inbox. And then, you know, if that was a lucky one, I got a thumbs up, you know, straight away on that. But that to me is, that's the thrill of doing this. But having said that, just to finish off what I was saying, I also love taking 2 years to make a record. That's a highly enjoyable. That's not a thrill ride. That's a lazy river. You know, this is lovely. We're floating down. The sun's shining. You know, it's one of those. It's not a roller coaster.
It's the holiday that you mentioned, isn't it? It's the holiday of a writing rather than the sort of frantic overnight writing. Interesting you mentioned Hans Zimmer as well, and that, you know, you recognise him immediately at the top of your screen. Are you a big fan of that kind of orchestral sound? And he's a good example of somebody who blends genres and brings electric guitars into symphony orchestras. Is that an inspiration for you?
Well, do you know what? It's kind of... That points out what we talked about earlier, that, you know, Hans is one of those guys where you can sit and listen to it, read a script and go, okay, I know what it is. It's two pianos and a church organ. And he will reinvent himself constantly. And I do believe the reason he does that is to keep his songwriting fresh. I think if he had the same piano sound and string patch up, We'd hear the repetition, and that's the danger of songwriting. That is, I never want my audience to go, oh, I love this new album. It's just like the last one. That's a fail. That's a fail right there. We've always got to be pushing ourselves and pushing our audience.
You mentioned the organ there, which you are no stranger to since a boy.
That's right.
Is it fair to say that, you know, because you're a fantastic instrumentalist yourself, piano player, you learnt on this amazing Yamaha organ. What did that instrument teach you, and how's that kind of influenced maybe what you're writing today?
Well, yeah, so basically, I didn't start on piano. I started on a tiny little keyboard with tiny keys. And then the upgrade from that my, you know, my parents saw, there's a bit of raw talent here, we're going to upgrade that, was a two manual and bass pedals organ, Yamaha organ. So I basically spent the next 6 months looking at my feet, teaching my left foot how to play an octave of bass notes. And what I didn't realise while that was going on is my hands. I didn't need to look at them. If you ever watch me performing live, I never look at my hands as I'm playing because of those days where I was learning the bass pedals. And then for the next few years, all I did was play cover versions, standards, you know, Neil Diamond, Frank Sinatra, Lionel Richie, Barry Manilow, I mean, you name it, you know, that it was just a way of entertaining these working men's club audiences. But by the time I started writing when I was 15, what I didn't, sorry, this is the longest answer to the shortest question, but let me just finish off what I'm going to say. What I didn't realise is those years of playing all those cover versions is I was getting inside the compositions. I was getting into the DNA of, why are these records so popular? Why do people, oh, I know why. It's that chord structure. Hang on, it's the main, hang on, now the chorus has gone minor. That's why, and it's like a big masterclass on the history of music. So by the time I got to write when I was 15, I was possibly just putting all the things I'd played and learned into a mixer, and out came songs like Million Love Songs. So it was a, you know, that was my way of, rather than exams and, you know, playing lots of pieces, my craft was being learned on a stage playing these cover versions.
And also the organ compared to the piano, if you started with that, you've got the layers of an orchestra at your hands and feet, because you're playing one line with your feet, one line with your right hand, another with your left. So actually, you know, yeah, going back to the symphony idea and working with an orchestra, you know, maybe you have been sort of teaching yourself to think orchestrally from that age. Because it's one of the things that surprises people when I chat to them about a kind of classical composer's mindset, is that I can hear an orchestra and I can hear the different layers and the different instruments.
Sure, sure.
it in my head. And I play the organ, probably not as well as you. I'm not a good organist at all. I think it helps you, as you say, get inside the music and the different lines and layers of the orchestra.
It's like a big picture. And like you say, you know, on the organ, there was like a string patch or a vibraphone patch. And so all of a sudden, you know, I know what that is. You know, it's not like, what's that? I knew what it was, but I just heard the Yamaha version of it. But it does, you know, it's a big, the musical, as you hear something, it's so multidimensional. Of course, we just hear it with our two ears, but we know there's this big canvas, and up the top here is all the high pitch, and at the low is all the bass. You know, as it goes, it's my feet down low playing the bass stuff, and slowly it works up through the shape of your hands. Then the higher pitched instruments of the right hand, and then the violas and the cellos with your chord hand, and it totally taught me what the orchestra did.
Do you play Christmas carols on the organ?
I do.
So we have a big normal year, have a Christmas carol service with Gary Barlow on the organ.
Do you know what? It's so I even play Star Wars. I mean, I can play everything on an organ, everything. Copacabana, Tico Tico, Bossa Nova's The Girl from Ipanema. I mean, honestly, I am the entertainment in the house. And you know what the other thing is? I will privately send you a picture once we've done this, but my old organ has just been serviced after, 35 years. It's just been serviced, and it's like a Ferrari. It's come back. It's a dream.
So I need to see it. I'm the kind of person who could spend a whole day in a piano showroom, you know, just sort of covered.
Listen, I will send it you, and you can share it with your audience on here. I'm not precious about it, but it's a beautiful instrument.
Okay. Oh no, I look forward to it. A little early Christmas present, and of course, looking slightly further ahead into January. Happy birthday, I should say.
Your thank you.
Birthday coming up. Is the Gary Barlow of 2021 going to be the same Gary Barlow as this year and the one in the past?
I think it's a big question for everyone, isn't it? I think that if you've not been affected by the last 9 months, you're possibly not human. I think whether we like it or not, it's going to come out what we've just all been through. Some of us have been reacting to it already. Some of us, it might take a few years, but the world's going to be different after this, which means we're going to be different. You know, I've, you know, without sounding like an idiot, you know, I'm a really busy person. I do somewhere between 100 and 150 flights a year. Loads of gigs, and I kind of look and go, I don't know if I'm going to go back to that. I don't know if I'm going to go back to that amount of craziness where it constantly feels out of control. I don't know if I want that anymore. And the peace and the sort of the foundation of being at home, I'm a better writer. It's something I've discovered. I listen to music more than I've done in years. I appreciate things more than I appreciate. I don't want to lose it. I don't want to go back to how it was before. And I fear there's a lot of people who are feeling the same. Yeah. But we'll see. We'll see.
Yeah. Well, I'm very excited to see what you do next. As you say, we never know what is coming next. And that's part of the excitement of it, to see where music takes.
That's it.
But music played by humans is available now, just in time for Christmas, like it was planned, Gary. Thank you so much for joining us.
You're welcome.